Rancher. So adding the work of the core next generation repositories working group is organized or has been organized along various user stories, and I'm here to present you two of them. The first one is text and data mining, and the second one is recommender systems. My name is Peter North. I'm representing on the core next generation repositories working group, the Open University and JISC. I work as the team leader on the core aggregation project, which actually kind of takes very seriously the need to aggregate full text content actually for text and data mining. And I'm also part of the Open-Minded project, which is an EU infrastructure project which aims to build a platform for text and data mining scholarly literature. So let me go quickly to the first story. What I will try to do is to explain why the working group feels that these particular stories are important, what we can do, and why we should do it, really. So, what do we want to achieve? We, as a human or a machine user, I want to be able to mine text or data from the collective content of repositories. Why do we want to do it? Obviously, one of the main reasons is that it's really difficult to do with the existing publisher systems, as I will probably explain to you later. But access to content in general, to scientific content, even if we have open access, is complicated if you want a machine to basically process vast amounts of information. And we can do a lot, but we can't do it. It creates lots of benefits. So what do we see repositories? What kind of support they need to provide in order for us to be able to move forward? So we see repositories as an enabling infrastructure for text and data mining. The text and data mining activity needs to happen, in our opinion, outside of the repository, because often this requires running kind of very heavy computational processes, and text and data mining has many shapes and sizes. So basically, you can't really say that, you know, something would locally happen, you know, on a small server sitting in the library. So that's what we obviously want to avoid. What data? So obviously, repositories has been so far kind of trying to very well. Sorry, I can hear myself. So the repositories have been really well working with regards to metadata sharing, but in terms of content sharing, this has been a little bit of a problem. So nice. This one, good. Okay, perfect. So, but also one of the things which is not available at the moment from repositories and has a lot of value for text and data mining are data sets and kind of anonymous user interaction logs. They're really very valuable for building particular services, and at the moment there's no way to get this information out, and that really benefits a lot to the commercial providers who have actually this user interaction data available. So for example, Elsevier has a lot of data about who accessed what resource, and that actually helps them to build better services for researchers. Unless we, as the repositories community, enable the sharing of this information, we will not be able to build competitive services with respect to these, with regards to these providers, and they will be basically with a better technology, they will have more money, so you can see where this will lead to. So, why is it important to support text and data mining? So first of all, no researcher has the time to read all scientific literature. In fact, 85% of researchers say that they cannot even read key literature in their own field. So that's a really big issue. With recent advancements in artificial intelligence, machines can read literature at scale. They can't read it as well as we do as humans, but they can do a lot for us. New discoveries by text and data mining research literature have already been simulated in real life. So what we've seen, for example, is that the discovery of the link between migraine and magnesium deficiency has been simulated by text and data mining experiments. So no research has been done in the lab. The knowledge was already there within the scientific literature, and what was missing is for an algorithm to find that actually that in building information retrieval systems for researchers, building recommender systems, literature-based discovery is exactly what I was just talking about. So really the ability to actually make discoveries by doing text and metadata mining. Metadata enrichments, I mean, I probably don't have to explain that. You know, this library has really suffered from the need to annotate resources, and it's a lot of manual labor and so on. Text data mining can assist in that process in many situations. Expert search, you know, people looking for who is an expert in a particular field, a typical area of text and data mining. Exploratory search, so going beyond keyword search. Fact checking, these days very important stuff with misleading news and so on. We need basically scientific literatures can be used to back particular claims or actually dispute certain claims which are made in the media. A lot of researchers are doing that particular work, and scientific literature is a very, very valuable resource, as you can probably understand, in this process. There are obviously many applications of text and data mining for kind of domain-specific disciplines. Life sciences in particular, they have been using text and data mining for years. Research evaluation, one of the areas is semantometrics. Cross-linking, you know, finding basically patterns that are related to research literature to basically check for companies, for example, that an idea which is found in research literature, they can exploit it, is obviously really, really important. And there are many others. Text and data mining of research literature at scale so far could only be done by the privileged few. And by the privileged few, I mean those companies that manage to have agreements with the publishers. So that means Google, Microsoft, and so on. Because the other people used to have very limited access to scientific knowledge, especially the subscription knowledge. So, so this is one of the real problems. But apart from that, the real key issue here is that we need seamless and efficient access to the collective content from repositories for harvesting metadata and content. So I represent the core project, that's why I have core, but you can possibly imagine other aggregators being there. And what core does is basically it's perhaps the largest aggregate of full text content from repositories, and it's really complicated to do that. So we do that by OAIPMH. We aggregate from open access repositories and open access journals. And really one of the focuses of CORE is to act as a bridge between the repository and the text and data mining professional. With OAIPMH, there come many, many issues. First of all, it's slow and very inefficient for big repositories. It is standardized for metadata transfer, but it has never been designed for content transfer. So it has never been designed with the idea that this is something that will serve as a delivery mechanism for text and data mining. And it's very difficult to represent the richness of metadata from a broad range of data providers using OAIPMH, because Paolo can probably tell you a lot, and Friedrich as well, that's why we have so many harmonization processes, and that why integrating resources from thousands of providers is so complicated. One of the things which we propose is the Next Generation Repositories Working Group is to actually replace the OAIPMH with a protocol of resourcing, or maybe supplement it in the very least, so that we can actually aggregate both metadata and content from repositories efficiently. I would say that one of the key issues in repositories is that often when we find metadata, it's actually very difficult for the machines to even find what content object the metadata refers to. And I would argue that, as librarians, you will probably understand, or many people are librarians with that background, you will understand that a metadata record without a particular link to what it is really kind of meaningless. So, just want to kind of show you one particular example of what we've been doing. So my team at CORE, we've been basically piloting a system which we call the Publisher Connector, which harvests content from very kind of non-standard APIs of the publishers, and it's only open access content. We harvest from especially the big elephants, Elsevier, Wiley, Springer, Taylor and Francis, and others. So far we've aggregated in this way about 1.5 million papers, and this is growing. And what we aim to do is, what we've done is these were all non-standard APIs, so the harvesting process was very complicated. And it's been done, we had to basically create specialized software for each publisher. And then we've basically made all of these resources available via resources. We're now adjusting those data into core, and we're also in discussion with OpenAI about how we provide data to them. So 1.5 million full text papers from these key publishers is about 20% increase, for example, of full text content for core. So it's really important data set, and it's also kind of, it justifies that we couldn't really use OERP image for that particular purpose, because OERP image doesn't work well for very good repositories. So that's what kind of instigated the development and the application of resources in this particular scenario. But we would like to see resources being adopted across repositories as well. And then the data are obviously provided to the Open Mindset platform, which is basically the project which also builds the algorithm for text and data mining. So Open Mindset will be the platform where a text miner comes, they have the data available as well as the algorithms. So, but there are other things that are happening. I would say there's a lot of interest from text analytics companies and researchers in various disciplines in accessing very large amounts of publications for various kind of analytical purposes or for building services. There are also workshops. For example, we organized the workshop on scientific mining. We've been organizing for the last 6 years the workshop on mining scientific publications was, and there have been others. But what we hear from the text miners every year, and we always ask this question, we ask the question, what is the main barrier to text and data mining scientific literature? And they say access to data. So let me now tell you a little bit, go very quickly through recommender systems. So that story is about the user wanting to receive recommendations about content, such as papers, data sets, software, people to follow, grant opportunities, methods, conferences, and so on. That is of interest to them, so they can continuously increase knowledge in their field. Why is this important? So what we really want to do is to increase the accessibility of resources in the repositories. I mean, that's a clear seller for the repositories community. And I think what I really want to say is that we already have a recommender system in place, and we see twice as often people accessing resources on core via our recommender system than via our search. And that also, I believe, is quite a strong, convincing argument for the adoption of recommender systems across repositories. And what we need is that, obviously, the recommender system, they provide, I will actually get back to it on the next slide, they provide an essential glue to link related content across the global infrastructure of repositories. And finally, recommender systems are the basis for building some sort of social networking functionality over repositories content. Now, you might not like social networks, and I'm not a big fan either. But one of the things which we need to realize is that unless repositories provide some sort of functionality for people to discuss the content that's deposited there, they will become kind of silos of content, and no one will be visiting them. And what will happen then, and I fear actually that it's happening already, is that we will have platforms, commercial platforms, where these social functionalities will be implemented very well, and they will make the repositories network completely obsolete. I would like to share one particular example with you. That is, there has been a study conducted by one particular research institution in the UK recently, and they were looking into the attitudes of researchers in terms of sharing their publications in repositories, but also on these commercial social media platforms. And researchers, in general, the result was that researchers are a lot happier to share their publications with those such as ResearchGate than with their own institution repositories. And I think that is something very worrying. And part of that reason might be that they see clear value in sharing their content on those platforms, because people can discuss that particular work and they don't see the value of the repository. So I think that we have to really cater to those people, because otherwise we become we won't be needed, basically. So I would like to give you an example of the core recommender. It's something which we are going to present at the Open Repositories 2017 paper, but I would like to see a lot more recommenders being done by other people and other groups as well. So what it does is it provides recommendations for over 70 million metadata and about 8 million full texts research papers which we have in CORE. It's been integrated in over 10 repositories already, and it's also integrated in CORE. We have a particular plugin for ePrint, so for ePrint it's really easy to install it, but it's also applicable for DSpace and open journal systems and others. It recommends articles based on visiting a particular page. So this is, for example, how it looks in the White Crows Research Online Repository, so it's an institution repository in the UK which integrated that plugin. So based on a paper which the person see, we recommend other similar papers from other repositories. But as I told you, this is still very limited because and we recommend it based on text, based on understanding that people want more recent content, that people want that metrics could be sometimes important, so people want popular content often or prefer popular content, and we also try to show the user quality records. So, for example, one of the things we do, we validate that the full text is available. That's why all of these resources have thumbnails, for example. We process the full text and we make sure that actually when someone clicks on it, that they will actually find the content. So that's really an important aspect. But one of the limitations of this is that this is still a recommender for articles only, but we can recommend a lot more things. We can recommend people, we can recommend collaborators, we can recommend grants, and many other things. And we need to have these systems in place if we are ever to build a social network over the global network of repositories. Now, there are two particular problems in repositories which I see. The recommender which I showed you is a non-personalized recommender, so everyone who will go to that particular page will see exactly the same recommendations. But the most successful recommendation systems, at least in the commercial sector, are all personalized. In order to do that, we would need some sort of global sign-on within repositories so that people can, and I would like to say, because I know this is a complicated topic, that would need to be voluntary. So only those people who want to sign in, they would need to sign on. But if you don't want to, then you have non-personalized recommendations. And that's absolutely fine. Also, there's another particular problem. The recommenders which can be built at the moment within repositories need to be based on a method called content-based filtering, which basically recommends similar articles based on the analysis of their content. However, the state of the art in the recommender system follows the idea of collaborative filtering, which really makes use of information such as that the particular user, the idea is that if I'm a user and tends to access computer science papers, then maybe I want to access a paper which I haven't seen before, but other computer science people say or go to and say that it's good. Okay, so that's the idea of collaborative filtering. These are the best recommenders which have been validated by the research community that they work really very well. These recommenders cannot be built on the repositories network at the moment because the repositories don't share the user box. They can be done easily by those such as by the big elephants such as Elsevier because they have this information. So I just want to make you aware. So what we recommend is that we would like to see some support within repositories for a voluntary global sign-on. We would like to see openly releasing anonymized user interaction data to enable the creation of effective research recommender systems. And in terms of the conclusions from both of these, we see that the repositories are a key infrastructure which should enable text and data mining, and they should be effective, they should provide effective support for harvesting. And I've just mentioned the tool for the recommender systems, and I'd like to say also that the CORE Next Generation Repositories Working Group really wants to see the repositories succeed. But we believe that the repositories can only be successful as long as our technology is competitive with the other offerings.